Now, the return of the Sony Gold-winning series in which Sue McGregor gathers together groups of people who have shared a common experience. In this first program, with some passionately held beliefs strongly expressed, one of our most prominent aunt's institutions is under the spotlight in The Reunion.
A decade ago, at the end of 1997, one of Britain's most famous artistic institutions appeared to have hit rock bottom. The Royal Opera House in Covent Garden, home too of the Royal Ballet, was closed. It had shut down 6 months earlier for renovation. But it was in dire need of more than just physical rebuilding. The previous year, a BBC television documentary called The House had shown in almost comical detail what appeared to be disastrous mismanagement at the top. In December 1997, the Department of Culture, Media and Sport Select Committee brought out a critical report which spoke of arrogance and presumption in the Opera House's use of public money and recommended that the chief executive and indeed the entire board should go. Today's reunion brings back together some of the people who struggled to save an institution at the heart of the debate over the part the arts play in public life and how much of the public purse they deserve.
Whether it's Sutherland or Fontaine, Callas or Lucia Pop, for performers, everything in the garden is far from lovely.
By the late 70s, productions were increasingly lavish and expensive. There was typically an opera chorus of 90, an orchestra of 100, and over 1,000 permanent staff, all squeezed into a Victorian building.
It's really a most impractical house at the moment. It was never built to do what it's doing today.
The technical director was Tom MacArthur.
As far as facilities and storage, we have probably almost the worst facilities in the world, I'm afraid.
And the conditions are atrocious for this particular point in time.
An urgent appeal for funds was launched in 1979 to finance the first stage of the modernisation of the Royal Opera House. Their royal patron was Prince Charles.
In search of how many millions for the Royal Opera House?
Well, a lot.
Opera costs so much because it involves all the arts.
Opera ticket prices at Covent Garden were among the highest in the world.
Stars' fees are confidential, but top singers can earn £5,000 a performance.
Critic Gillian Widdicombe.
If you're lucky enough to get tickets for one of the really great evenings, it's worth whatever it costs you.
But that wasn't the view at the Arts Council, and in the early 1980s, the size of the annual grant to the Opera House was diminishing.
In 1983-84, the Royal Opera House...
Margaret Thatcher's Arts Minister, Lord Gowrie, was forced to defend the cuts in Parliament.
Last year I recognised, and this does pose real difficulties for Sir Clowes and his board, the rise was only 2%, but one can't have a good year every year.
The first visible sign of a real crisis was when the orchestral musicians threatened a walkout in 1985.
After a week of cancellations, the Royal Opera House in Covent Garden is back in business tonight due to the intervention of a mystery benefactor. He gave £10,000 to settle a strike by musicians.
As well as handouts from generous benefactors, the young viewers of Blue Peter were invited to support the Opera House's future and its attempts to raise £57 million to fund the new building.
You need 9.50 to provide this amount of special sprung flooring for the new rehearsal rooms at Covent Garden, which is essential, of course, for the dancers.
Naturally, that's a tremendous challenge. It's tremendously exciting. I mean, obviously, it's an architect's dream in a way.
In 1984, architect Jeremy Dixon, with colleagues Ed Jones and Bill Jack, was chosen for the job after intense competition.
Mixture of possibilities, so it's tremendously exciting.
Well, round the table with me today are five people who remember the epic crisis that hit the Royal Opera House only too well. Sir Jeremy Isaacs, General Director of the Royal Opera House from 1988 to the end of 1996. Nicholas Payne, Director of Opera there between 93 and 98. Chris Smith, now Lord Smith, Culture Secretary between 97 and 2001. Architect Jeremy Dixon, now Sir Jeremy, who designed the transformation of the Opera House building. And the dancer and now Creative Director of ROH2 at the Royal Opera House, Deborah Bull. Opera is a very expensive art. It's seen with ballet as pretty elitist by a lot of people. First of all, what attracted you to this world, to work in it, Nicholas Payne?
I was attracted to work in it when I was still at university. And I used to escape, hitchhike up the A1 in order to sit in the gallery at Covent Garden for both opera and ballet.
Deborah Ball as a dancer, it wasn't as glamorous backstage as some people might suppose.
No, that's right. I joined in September 1981. We had no studios at all at Covent Garden. We shared the dressing rooms with the opera, so after the show you'd have to bundle your things away so that the opera could get in the next night. It was, yes, it was pretty decrepit.
Jeremy Dixon, you came into this world as an architect. What was your impression of the Royal Opera House that you tried to transform?
It's very interesting. When I look back, my father used to bring me to the Opera House when I was about 8. But after that, I didn't go much to the Opera House until the competition. And then immediately after the competition, we were taken round the house and Scholte was rehearsing Rosenkavalier. So we'd go in and out of the auditorium, hear snippets of this and snippets of that and shouting at a flautist and various things going on, which was a magical thing because that piece of music is itself a collage of ideas of music.
Chris Smith, we're back in the 80s still. What was your view of the Opera House, the Royal Ballet? Were you a punter at the time?
Oh, I was a punter and I came and I loved what I saw because... And the thing about opera... particularly, is, yes, it's terribly expensive to put on, but there's a reason for that. It combines music and costume and scenery and acting and drama and song. It puts them all together and creates something very special on the stage.
Jeremy Isaacs, before you took on this immensely difficult and controversial job and you got landed in all sorts of hot water and had to fight your way across it, you're looking cross at me saying that. What was your view of the Royal Opera House?
The Royal Opera House was absolutely tremendous and wonderful. I fell in love with opera more in Glasgow and Edinburgh and Oxford than I did in London, because I didn't live in London. And I fell in love with ballet when I saw Margot Fonteyn dance Sleeping Beauty at the Opera House in Manchester. And I have never, ever thought that opera or ballet were elitist art forms.
And yet from, I suppose, the mid-70s to the time you were invited to be general director of the Royal Opera House, you had... in a sense, to look forward to what was going to be an immensely difficult task.
Well, you may believe tasks are difficult, but that doesn't daunt anybody who's got any commitment at all to doing a decent job in life. The problem with the Royal Opera House in the 70s and early 80s was twofold. First of all, it had been consistently underfunded for years, and there were 100 productions on the books, 70 or 80 of which were 30 years old, and they were kept wrapped up in a store under the stage. The place needed a bunk up.
Was that a sort of criticism levelled at ballet very much, Deborah?
I think ballet's always had a gentler ride than opera, sort of historically. Looking back over some of my own diaries from the time, I see that, you know, time and time again, it was the opera that was going to, should be closed down. The Royal Ballet should continue to receive public subsidy. I mean, I think the ballet is slightly cheaper. We have an in-house company and reliance on fewer guest stars, which keeps the cost down.
And it had been a great, great company.
Yeah.
And Chris Smith, of course, the theme running through, as far as the public was concerned, and indeed politicians like yourself, through these times, was how much money should government give to ventures like the Royal Opera House?
Absolutely. And I was always very firmly of the view that we needed to fund the Opera House properly. But in return for funding it properly, I think we needed to try and solve this conundrum of the fact that it was an expensive art form, but a relatively small number of people were able to go there, sit in the seats and enjoy it.
Because of the ticket prices?
Not just because of the physical size of the Opera House.
I think the access thing is really important if you go back to the early 80s. That was the beginning of the debate about access. And this is very key to what we're talking about. The building in Covent Garden was absolutely mitigated against access. It was designed to open its door when the vegetable and fruit traders had gone home.
And that was one of the things you were keen to change, Jeremy Dixon.
Yes, right from the outset, we were looking at bringing the ballet company back onto the main site, but we were also looking at public access and the possibility of linking the new life in Covent Garden Square, of getting people to walk through the building without necessarily using it as opera goers. Anything that enlarges the public spaces gives a sense of drama and excitement to being a member of the public exploring the building.
It was an old building, it was creaking at the seams, it hadn't been rewired for 20 odd years. It was an issue of health and safety every season with Westminster City Council if they'd give us a certificate to allow us to go on. The house had to be redeveloped a competition was held.
Black tie, white shirt, the old long dinner jacket, right, a little tail on it, we call it penguins.
Talk of
right?
The Royal Opera House was everywhere. Even Harry Enfield's Loads of Money character got some digs in on the high ticket prices.
£100, I go, cheap tonight, and we'll have loads!
But even those in the world of the high arts were critical of the supposed extravagance of the Opera House. Conductor Stephen Barlow.
You don't need to have a chorus of 90. You don't need to have elephants for Aida. The soprano doesn't need to be fat.
No one who works in serious opera production now is interested in that type of staging.
Jonathan Miller, who directed less extravagant productions at English National Opera down the road.
What you get, in effect, is the impression of an ageing dowager trying to do the twist.
This model shows the new face of Britain's oldest opera house. Its most controversial feature is its 100 feet high fly tower, which was...
Planning objections came thick and fast.
What they're going to use it for is primarily an office development, with a pretty arcade and shops, but nothing to do with cultural facilities.
I think that a great deal of the fuss...
Jeremy Isaacs jumped to the defence of the redevelopment plan.
And people think that it's proposed to build the National Westminster Tower here, but it ain't.
To help increase accessibility, one of Placido Domingo's starring roles was relayed to non-paying audiences on big screens outside.
Opera is currently riding a wave of popularity. 100,000 people saw Pavarotti in Hyde Park, but few of them can afford to see him in Covent Garden. The recession has hit those that can, and box office receipts have been falling.
Royal Opera House in Covent Garden has cancelled all its
opera. And there were more rumblings from the pit.
The musicians have been offered an increase of 5.5%, but they want 20 to 24% over 2 years.
With the Opera House £3.5 million in the red, accountants Price Waterhouse were called in, and the Arts Council commissioned a report from Baroness Warnock.
The Royal Opera House today released a summary of the Warnock report, and it has some tough things to say.
The tendency has been to decide what was artistically right first and count the cost later.
The Independent's music critic David Lister.
It's not because of underfunding. The reports hardly mention underfunding. The reports say it's due to poor management, inefficiency, undue attention to economy. This is a totally different ballgame.